Welcome back. In this video, I will build on the framework that Carlos introduced in the previous lecture. We are going to explore how to measure the security level of an organization, or a set of organizations, or even a country. Of course, it gets harder if you have to measure it at higher levels of analysis, but conceptually it will contain the same elements. So what are these elements to measuring security levels? Well, here's the rub. Security level is not something you can directly observe or measure. It's what we call a latent construct, similar to human intelligence. You cannot observe someone's intelligence directly. You may infer it from their behavior. Let's say you see them solve a difficult puzzle, but that behavior is not itself intelligence. It's an indicator of intelligence. So you measure latent constructs by defining indicators that correlate reliably with the construct. This is how intelligence metrics, like the IQ test, work. Different parts of the test generate different indicators that together reliably correlate with what we consider intelligence. It's the same for security. We can measure indicators or metrics that reflect different aspects of the security level. They all have their own strengths and weaknesses. Like an IQ test, you ideally want to include all these aspects when developing an estimation of the security level. Using the horizontal axis of the framework, so moving from left to right, from cost to benefits, we can distinguish four types of security metrics. Metrics based on controls, on vulnerabilities, on incidents, and on prevented losses. En route from cost to benefit, we bring in more and more of the threat environment. Controls are closest to the cost. They are the measures that are put in place to mitigate risk. These metrics do not look at how the control actually functions vis-a-vis an attacker, but whether it's in place and whether it meets the specifications. Vulnerabilities are metrics that evaluate how these controls perform in light of a certain threat scenario. Think of a penetration test. So these metrics are not based on actual attacks, but on hypothetical attacks. Once a vulnerability, which may or may not have been known beforehand, actually gets exploited, we have an incident. So in this type of metric is the first where the controls actually meet a real attacker. And finally, there are metrics that try to map incidents on losses or prevented losses. Here, the metric is not only driven by the incident itself, but by the economic impact of the incident, which means taking into account what the attacker actually did. We will now go through each type of metric in a bit more detail. Controls are the measures implemented to mitigate risk, as I said before. Controls can be physical, for example, building security. They can be organizational, for example, having an incident response team. They can be procedural, like a credential management policy, and they can also be technical, such as using data encryption and firewalls. Metrics based on controls typically check the existing controls against some framework of supposedly required controls. So it might say that 8 out of 10 controls are in place. Typically, they also try to rate the maturity of the control. In other words, how developed and extensive it is. Do you have one person doing incident response or a whole team? If you have a team, is it just handling incidents or has it been trained to uncover incidents by itself? Vulnerabilities are weaknesses in the controls that could be leveraged by a certain type of attack. The first step in identifying vulnerabilities is to analyze how the controls could fail. This could be the outcome of an audit of automated tools like scanners, or of alerts sent out by computer emergency response teams. They may point to newly discovered weaknesses in your services or controls. These approaches all check whether known vulnerabilities are present in your systems. If you want to discover unknown vulnerabilities, you need a bit more ingenuity, more creative effort. Typical techniques here are penetration testing or red teaming. It is important to realize that vulnerability metrics are driven by attack scenarios. The scenario may be completely hypothetical, or it may be based on an attack that occurred elsewhere. For example, you probably heard about the infamous Stuxnet attack. When this attack became known, a lot of firms operating industrial control systems suddenly began to wonder about whether this could affect their operations as well. Or they were told by security consultants that they should wonder about this attack scenario for their own organization. The attack scenarios bring in something of the presumed threat environment. Of course, many anticipated attacks never materialize, and some unanticipated ones do. A system could be full of unpatched software vulnerabilities, but it might not be exploited because it's not attractive for a certain type of attacker. For example, some research actually suggests that the most outdated pieces of content management software turn out to be attacked less than the more recent versions. Incidents are where the controls meet the real threat environment. Here, actual attacks occur, which may or may not be successful or costly to the organization. Information security controls are imperfect in various ways. They can be poorly implemented or fail in unexpected ways. Incidents shed light on the state of the controls, which you might not otherwise learn about. We can detect these incidents through many different means, with varying levels of detail and fidelity. Some are easy to detect, others hard. Automated tools like event monitoring systems can help, but they typically also generate large volumes of false alarms that have to be processed and analyzed. More advanced attacks are typically harder to detect. Even with controls in place, some successful attacks have gone undetected for months or even years. A final indicator of the security level are prevented losses. Mapping incidents to losses is hard, as it requires us to quantify intangibles. For example, it's hard to quantify the losses after a data breach, like the one that happened at the US retail chain Target. It's even harder to map prevented incidents to prevented losses, as that would require us to forecast and monetize the consequences of an incident that didn't happen. Moreover, the causation between an incident that didn't happen and a reason why it didn't happen is typically hard to establish. Did incident rates drop because of failed attacks or because of fewer attacks? To conclude, we have classified different types of security metrics in four categories. Each category relates differently to the threat environment. Controls exclude the threat environment. Vulnerabilities keep it static. These metrics are therefore deterministic. Incidents and prevented losses are stochastic, as they are driven by unknown attacker behavior as well as the actions of the defender. Similarly, controls are mainly driven by actions, for instance, acquiring a new firewall, while incidents and losses are driven by events, for example, a data breach. Okay, now that the framework is in place, we can use it to better understand existing metrics, and that is the topic of the next lecture.